Okay, hello everyone. Welcome to session 7, our second to last session of the Energy Cultures Conference. Just a quick note on the structure of this session. We're going to have a keynote and then around 10 minutes or so for questions. And then we're going to have our two speakers and we're going to do the same thing as the other sessions and that we'll have the panel of questions at the end. Okay, so first of all, I'd like to introduce our keynote, Janet Stephenson, who is the director of the Centre for Sustainability and the leader of the Energy Cultures Project. And Janet is going to talk about energy cultures as an integrative framework. So welcome, Janet.
Kia ora koutou. Can you hear that? Is the sound enough? No? We'll just get Becky to adjust the volume. All good? Okay. First of all, it's lovely to be here and lovely to have such a receptive audience to the ideas that are flowing through this room over the last day and a half. And it's also wonderful to have been experiencing both our own team and also other researchers using the framework or other theories to try and understand behaviour and transitions better. When I was thinking about what to talk about this afternoon, I had a number of different approaches that I took, and one of them was to try and tell you what we'd found out across the research as a whole. And then I thought, oh my God, you guys are first of all going to get bogged in detail, and secondly, I would probably talk for about 5 hours. And given that we do have some policy briefs that we're going to be producing in the next few months that are actually capturing the high-level findings and translating them into policy recommendations, I thought it was better to actually use this session to take a very much a bird's-eye view of the Energy Cultures Research Program and particularly the framework that we've developed and the ways in which this can help inform us and our ways of thinking and talking about behaviour and transition. So I'm going to talk about the Energy Cultures Framework in respect of how it helps us support research collaborations and then looking at it in the various ways that we use it to think about multiple sites and scales of energy culture, clusters of them, habitual behaviour, and particularly what we're interested in is how do you change energy behaviour. So quite a bit of a focus on that, and then how we use energy cultures to inform policy and to think about transitional change. So I actually showed this image yesterday, but this is really just reinforcing that we are very much an interdisciplinary collaboration of people with lots of different ideas, lots of theories that are driving us, lots of different methods that we would use to investigate the questions that are important, but initially lacking a way of talking to each other in a way that made sense. And there are many theories of behaviour and behaviour change, and we've had some of them talked about today by different people, or they've been implicit in the way that people have talked about their topics, and some look at what the individual thinks about, some look at actually what are the social or contextual drivers of change, but each of us brings a theory with us, whether it's one of those or one of a million other ones, that actually shapes our thinking and also our language. And because of that, within energy cultures, because we're bringing together engineers, economists, social scientists, but also we want to communicate to policymakers, we want to communicate with businesses, and we want to communicate with communities, when we try and talk together, it can just end up as a complete babble. So how do we create a way to bring us together? So the energy cultures framework, as I mentioned briefly yesterday, consists of some very, very simple cut-down ideas. And so what we talk about is how what we do is driven very much by the material culture, what we have in our lives, and also what we think, or what our norms, our expectations, our aspirations for our lives do consist of. And that framework is what we call an actor-centered approach. So we think about the material culture, practices, and norms of an individual, or of a household, or of a business, or maybe of an entire sector. And this way of thinking helps us think what is the material culture, practices, and norms that are specific to that actor, because that's what creates their own particular energy culture. So when we're talking about material culture, for example, of an individual or of a household, we might be looking at the structures, so what kind of building do they have, what kind of objects do they have in their home, what kinds of appliances do they use, how well insulated are they. If we're looking at practices, we're looking at activities, habits, and actions, even if they're only occasional actions, but our take on it is that even our occasional actions are driven by our cultural approaches, and particularly by our expectations, aspirations, and our personal and organisational norms. Of course, there are a whole lot of other things that drive how we think and our decision-making, and John was talking about some of those. So things like values, beliefs, rationalisations, knowledge, self-efficacy all come in there. But what we need to do, as I said, for the purposes of a framework that supports communication, is to cut these ideas down to a very simple set of ideas, understanding that underneath each of these, there are a whole variety of other theories that can inform how we might understand them. Oh, by the way, when I've got these bars down the bottom, they refer to published works that actually these ideas are talked about in. So if you want to follow up on any of the thoughts that are coming through here, then these are publications. So what the framework then also says is that the energy culture of any given individual, household, business, organisation, sector is very much also influenced by external influences that are beyond their control, or largely beyond their control. There are conditions in which they can control and impact on them, and we'll talk about those later when we talk about transitions. But of particular interest is just we're interested in the realm of influence of the actor within that circle, as opposed to things that are beyond that actor's realm of influence, or usually beyond the realm of influence. What we're also interested in is energy cultures at multiple sites and scales. So we can think about energy culture at a personal scale, or even just cutting it right down to what is your culture around your washing. So maybe one person in the household actually likes to hang their clothes outside because they like the freshness and the smell and the feeling that they're being using less power. And maybe somebody else is much more interested in actually saving time and getting their clothes dry for the next day, and so they put them in a tumble dryer. So that's two different energy cultures because they're carrying out different practices, and they're actually also involving different norms or expectations, and also involving different material culture. One's using a clothesline, the other is using a tumble dryer. We can also look at energy culture at a household scale, and Sarah, sorry, I've pinched a few of your pictures here, but actually looking particularly here at not only the structure of the house, but maybe what kind of heating devices it is. Practices might be heavily driven by whether you've got kids or not. So maybe you heat more rooms because your children need to keep healthy. Maybe you drive your kids to school because you'd feel safer about that than letting them go on bikes. And your norms, what are your expectations around heating, around how many rooms you heat, about whether you let your children go and play outside when it's cold or whether you keep them inside. We also look at energy culture within communities, and this is a piece of work that we did actually looking at the Blueskin Bay community, which Scott Willis is very involved in. He'll be talking later on today. And this piece of work was actually looking at what was driving the uptake of PV or solar energy in this community in particular, which was to do with the culture that particular community had developed that was driving change in people's uptake and understanding and expectations around PV. We also look at energy cultures amongst businesses, and Sarah's done quite a lot of work in this space, and really looking at how different their practices can be and also their norms. And she had a lovely story, which I'll repeat here, I hope I get it right, about one particular business that had people in the offices and then people on the factory floor, as it were. And the people in the offices had nice heaters and they were nice and warm, but when she said, could I go and talk to your people on the factory floor, they said, oh, I don't think that would be a good idea. They might want to have a bit of a moan at you. And when she dug into this, they said, we actually issue a thermal underwear as a matter of course, because the people out there, we can't afford to keep them warm, so they have to wear thermals instead. So some very different norms and practices within that business about the expectations about warmth. We also look at energy cultures in business sectors, and Debbie's talk, which you've just heard, is a really good example of that. So looking at the culture of freight, urban freight drivers in New Zealand, and also energy cultures of societal groups. We haven't talked about this today, but Generation Y having some very interesting emergent behaviours that are tending to make them want to get their driver's licence later or not at all, being less likely to drive and being less likely to own a car. So this is not all young people, but certainly an emergent group of young people who are behaving in quite different ways. And also we can think about energy cultures, or in this case for this paper, mobility cultures at a global scale. And here we were sort of comparing what we call the culture of speed in Beijing, a culture of experimentation in Masdar, and a culture of diversity in central London around their mobility provision. And what I do also like to talk about, particularly when I go overseas, is that New Zealand really does have a distinctive energy culture. And we've been talking about it a bit over the last day and a half, but we do have really poor housing stock. We use heat pumps incredibly compared to most other nations. If you go overseas and say 40% of New Zealand homes have heat pumps, they'll fall over, astonished. Old cars, we hang on to our cars for a long time. We buy them second hand, we hold on to them for an average of 13 to 14 years, and then they tend to kind of moulder in somebody's backyard somewhere. So we're really fond of our cars. And electric blankets, again, if you go to Europe, they say, what is an electric blanket? Is it something you smother people with? But anyway, yeah, they don't hear of them because their homes are so warm, they don't need them. So there's some really interesting material culture in New Zealand. I won't go into other aspects of energy culture, but just to say it is also possible to think about energy cultures on a cross-national scale. And also, we don't just talk about energy cultures. We've actually, adopted that same way of thinking to look at mobility cultures, as you've already heard, and also more recently looking at carbon cultures. So similarly, what are the norms, practices, and material culture that are driving particular patterns of greenhouse gas emissions in our daily or business lives? What we also do is look at distinctive clusters of energy cultures. And Rob Lawson, who was a dearly loved team member who's just retired or about to retire in a day or two's time, he's gone. He's overseas, right? Okay, so Rob was very much part of our team and, in fact, the co-leader of Energy Cultures right from the start. Rob did some work looking at energy cultures of households, clustering them, and really looking at this point, two dimensions of households. So looking at the degree to which, ultimately, his segmentation threw up four clusters of energy cultures in which the material culture and energy practices were either poor in terms of energy efficiency or energy efficient. And so out of that, identified four different groupings. And there's some interesting work around that. But as you heard yesterday, Ben is developing a three-dimensional model of energy cultures, taking norms into account as well. And we really look forward to the outcomes of that work. In terms of youth mobility cultures, Debbie's work identified really two or maybe three groupings of youth mobility cultures, the majority of whom are actually adopting what you call automobility, that is the dependence and acceptance that you're dependent on a car, but quite a number who are rejecting automobility either on a temporary basis while they maybe save money to go overseas or as a long-term commitment in their lives. Sarah's done some work also looking at energy cultures in business, and I won't go into this, but she's basically here identifying four particular clusters of business in terms of their interest in engaging with energy efficiency. So a frugal group, a do more with less group, an integrate group, and a group who are really out there making energy efficiency part of their business ethics or norms. The energy cultures framework can also help us think about habitual behaviour. So What we say is that when you've got a static or habitual energy culture, the material culture practices and norms are very strongly reinforcing each other. And here's an example, just some quotes, and these are picked from some interviews we did a few years ago, slightly tweaked to suit this audience better, so it's not exact quotes, but they're carrying the sense here. So in terms of norms, this person's saying, as a matter of principle, I don't like to waste, so they've got a very frugal set of norms. A material culture, my heating system suits me, I don't need to change. I think this person had a heat pump. But in terms of their practices, I try not to turn it on too much because I try not to use too much electricity. What we're seeing there is an energy culture that is static and internally driven by that person's own norms and expectations and material culture. So they're unlikely to change out of that unless something shifts. But we also see that energy cultures are often static because they're driven by external forces outside of people's control. And I think Fatima's talk about tenants actually really brought that into the air very well. But here's, this is actually a student living in a shared flat. My flatmates don't want us to use too much power because they want to spend money on other things, probably going to the rugby and the pub. Material culture, we're in a rental and there's just the heat pump in the main room, so the rest of the house is pretty cold. And practices, I just put on warm clothes when it's cold, and it's definitely about money. So money is really the driver of this and the flatmates' expectations. In fact, in many situations, we're seeing these static energy cultures driven by a combination of those internal drivers and also external drivers. But the cultures framework just helps you unpick how this might be being set up and what it might take to change. We also see static business cultures, and this here is just these pictures here from a piece of work that was actually the piece of work that kicked off energy cultures in the first instance, and we were asking the question, why are timber drying companies not picking up highly efficient timber drying technologies? And one of the findings from this was that individual firms are really locked into the culture of the industry as a whole. So the industry has certain industry norms, they invest in certain types of research, and they have particular types of practices which are really supporting the status quo and not driving in the direction of what might be a more rational economic choice. The other thing to bear in mind is that sometimes people's aspirations do have aspirations for change, but they are absolutely locked in by both their existing material culture and practices and also by these external influences. And so there is a disjunction between people's aspirations and where they're sitting at the moment, and clearly a lot of these tenants who are uncomfortable with their current household situation are people in that circumstance. So the more interesting question is changing energy cultures. And the first question you might ask is what drives change? What drives people from one energy culture to another? And often the kind of immediate response is it's got to do with financially rational decisions, it's got to do with values, or it's got to do with the fact that people don't know enough. Well, we know from our research and many other people's research that certainly financial rationality is not necessarily going to be a driver of energy efficient or low carbon decisions, and that example of the timber companies I was just giving you is just one example. Values is an interesting one. Now I'm using values here in the sense of really standard values, for example, respect for tradition or environmental values, so very high level values that people might hold. We did some research a number of years ago looking at the association between people's energy practices and investments and the values that they espouse to hold in relation to those energy practices and investments. What we found was that the same energy practice, for example, an energy efficiency practice, people would say related to quite different values depending on who you asked. And also, the same value could drive diametrically opposed actions or practices. So what we realised from that is that actually using values as the basis for thinking about behaviour change is not very helpful, certainly in the energy sphere, because the same value can drive different actions and the same actions can relate to different values. And of course, knowledge is not necessarily a driver of behaviour either. And Michelle's just been doing a whole series of focus groups with people about energy efficient driving. This isn't yet published, but I'm sure she won't mind me saying that one of the findings from that is that almost everybody she spoke to, I think there was about 100 people, they knew what energy efficient driving was, they knew how to do it, but did they do it? No. Other people should be doing it, not me. Another piece of work we did looked at home energy change, and this is really just looking at the variety of drivers of change. So in this piece of work, we asked people to reflect on their most recent home energy change at home that they'd been involved in personally. And we were interested in what are the change factors, kind of generic change factors that drove this. So knowing how bad your house is compared to others, experiencing a house with the change, etc., feeling it's become the norm. There are all of these different drivers. Some of them relate to actually making people feel they should do it, i.e. creating aspirations, and some of them were actually about making it happen, the choosing and enabling. But what was interesting is then finding out where do people actually get the impetus that helps them in these aspects of the decision. So TV advertising helps with a couple of things. Insulation and heating subsidies help with a few things. Home energy advice, that is people going into their homes, actually giving people individualised advice, helps with a few things. But what really helps is people's social networks. So in almost every case, people had been assisted by a family member or a friend, their social network, to make the change, either in guidance or going into their house and experiencing it, or in actually physically helping them do it. And so what we actually did was this lovely bubble diagram and all of the red circles are family and friends who've influenced decisions. All of the little dots are all of the individuals, and the other dots are other forms of information, for example, TV advertising and so forth. And that just really indicates how powerful social networks are in driving change in people's lives. Also, what is really interesting, and I think we've heard some talks that touch on this already, is that when you change one element, for example, your material culture, it can change others. So material culture, driving change in energy practices, and we heard about that in the Vanuatu talk actually yesterday. Energy practices, driving changes in norms, norms developing into new aspirations for new change, and that driving new uptake of material culture. So I think this is an interesting point when we talk about rebound, because when we talk about rebound, we're really talking about that link between uptake of new material culture and what it does in terms of changing energy practices. But what we need to see this as is not, rebound is not the only thing that is of interest in terms of that relationship, okay? It's not just about the fact that we might drive new aspirations and use more energy. It is also that there might be a learning experience and a culture change happening here once we get one of these things changing that might lead to wider changes. So I think rebound is certainly an issue, but it is not the only thing to focus on when you think about change following a material culture shift. When you change house, this is some research done by Daniel, who I don't think is here today. He was a PhD student. He's about to graduate. He was looking at what happens when people change house. So this is a new material culture, quite a significant material culture change. And this is a hobbit house, by the way. Nobody moved into this hobbit house, but I saw it on the internet, and I couldn't resist. For any of you who are just visiting New Zealand, you can go to Matamata and go and visit a hobbit house. But certainly there were some significant changes in people's practices and norms when they moved from one house to another. He interviewed them before, just after, and some long time after. What we've also done work around is how changes in practices or experience of different practices can drive changes in material culture and norms. And a nice example there is probably that quite a few of the young people who Debbie was interviewing had actually been overseas and had experienced great cycleways, had experienced the use of public transport, and they came back to New Zealand saying, actually, why can't it be different? Why can't it be like that here? And that had really changed their norms and also their expectations about what their material culture might be around mobility. And finally, new aspirations can obviously drive material culture change and practices. And a nice example there is the Blueskin Bay community, where the community worked together to try and develop a resilient energy future, what that might look like, and actually drove the uptake of both material culture change, more insulation, more solar, and also changes in practices in people's daily lives. But external influences can also drive change. So in some work we've done actually looking at global transport transitions, It's clear that new transport technologies and infrastructure are driving change, that new business models are driving change, changing social norms globally, including things like dematerialization, i.e. you can see transport as a service rather than physically owning a car. You might like to collaborate in the sharing of electricity rather than actually buying it off the grid. All of these changing social norms globally, which are often supported by other things like new technologies and information systems, are driving change as well. And also changes in policy and regulations obviously can drive change, such as London's, what do they call it? Yeah, that thing. fuel consumption information, transit lanes, and this here is for Barry. Actually, it's a bit unclear, but it's the pricing differentials for a fee-based scheme somewhere in Europe. So, how can energy cultures approaches inform policy development? Well, I think in a number of different ways, and one we've already talked about, and that is understanding how energy cultures can be seen as clusters of people with some similar characteristics that can then enable us to create specialised policy or policy directed at actually changing that group, whether it's a group of people in rental homes or it's a group of people who might be thinking of investing in electric vehicles. What Ben's work also has shown in terms of his survey work is that across New Zealand, we have a lot of unmet aspirations for change in people's energy lives. So a surprising percentage of New Zealanders actually would like to use active transport, would like to use public transport, but cannot because their external circumstances do not actually support that. What it can also do is to help us craft advice to fit the energy culture. And we had the presentation yesterday from Tasmania about using community events and personalised advice to try and encourage people to change their behaviour. And as I said, we actually did some similar research in this area. But actually, once you're engaging at that close level, either at a community level or at an individual level, you're providing advice that is particular to that person and to their circumstances and is much more likely to be taken up on than something that is a disembodied and generalised piece of advice. And Paul Thorsnes, who's also part of the Energy Cultures Programme, after this is going to talk about the personalised energy priorities software that he's developed, which actually enables people to go online, put in a whole lot of characteristics about themselves and their own personal choices about trade-offs and come up with advice that is particular, again, to that person. What we'd also say to the policy community is that it's really important to understand the problem as a system with feedback loops. And in the Energy Cultures Research Program, David Rees, who will be talking later on today, actually is our sort of system dynamics specialist, and we use system dynamics to actually bring together different flows of information to understand complex problems, feeding in all of our knowledge and looking at how it links together to create a bigger picture. And so this is just one piece of work that we've done, but we actually use this quite often, and it's an incredibly useful way to see your way past complexity into a little bit of structure in a very complicated situation. Another obvious outcome of this work is that there are certain real problem areas in which policy needs to be targeted. Energy efficiency is clearly one, and I think Jim, you showed how terrible New Zealand's energy efficiency advances had been compared to somewhere like the US. Which is embarrassing for us. Residential tenancies and housing performance are a really important area, which has been, I think, a policy black hole for far too long. And low carbon mobility, an area that we're starting to inch into, but a lot more work needs to be done. And there are others, but those are my top three. What the framework can also help you do is to actually help, help think in a rounded way about what kind of policy interventions might work in a particular situation. And I've got a three-step process here. This is completely out of my own head. We've not trialled this, but I think it's important, first of all, if you're looking at a policy area, to say, what are the characteristics of the energy culture that is under inquiry at the moment? So what, if you're looking at maybe a group of businesses or a group of householders, and you're interested in a particular topic area, how does the material culture, the practices and the norms fit with this policy change or the aspirations, the target of this policy intervention, and to what extent might your target outcome be aligned with where people are sitting at the moment with their energy culture. Secondly, how are external influences driving or preventing change? So in a as clear-headed a way as possible, what are the driver influences? What are the things that are driving change already out there in the wider world on the set of actors? And on the other hand, what are the barrier influences? What are the things that are slowing or preventing change in this situation? And then finally, how can we actually change those barriers by creating enablers to get across those barriers? So overcoming barriers, aligning policy. An example, and Barry's already talked about this today, is stimulating electric vehicle uptake. So, for example, we know that in terms of material culture, most New Zealand homes have a garage or a carport in which they can drive their car and plug it in to a 3-pin plug and thereby charge it up. Now, that's unlike many European countries, or the majority of households in European countries. Secondly, we know that New Zealanders' practices are well aligned to electric vehicles. The average commute is 22 kilometres. The average vehicle kilometres per day is something like 27. That's well within the range of even a low-batteried EV. We also know that New Zealanders' norms are well aligned. We know that somewhere between 60 to 80%, depending on what question you ask, of New Zealanders really like the idea of electric vehicles, even if they can't afford them today. So there's a very receptive energy culture or mobility culture towards the idea of electric vehicles. There's a bunch of drivers here. Electric vehicle costs are going down, charge time's going down. Oil price, who knows where that's going to go, but it's a vulnerability. EV range is going up, awareness is going up. But there's a bunch of barriers, and Barry has already talked about these at some length. And there are a number of enablers, again, which Barry has talked about, exactly these ones. And the policy change that the government has brought in does address in some ways some of those barriers, but there are two key ones which are not being addressed, and those are there, and there are probably others, but I think the upfront cost and actually discouraging other high emissions vehicles coming into the fleet are key areas that need to be addressed. So that's just an example of how you might use the framework to think about policy with culture and the culture of your actors in mind, in order to design something that has as best fit as possible with the outcomes that you're after. Finally, let's talk a little bit about transitional change. So there are a number of ways, I think, that transitional change can come about. And one is where externalities are reshaping people's energy cultures, whether that's at a household level or a business level or even a national or sectoral level. So things like changes in infrastructure, changes in policy, changes in market setups, new business models, those sorts of things can gradually or sometimes quite rapidly drive change in energy cultures until you get a critical mass for change. But more interestingly is where you're getting culture change reshaping externalities. So where you're getting individuals and increasingly groups of people starting to change their energy culture to such a critical mass that they're starting to drive expectations for new infrastructure, new policy responses, new markets, and new business opportunities. And we saw a great example of that this morning when we were talking about new models of the grid. So this is a consumer-driven change of multiple households in New Zealand and around the world who are becoming prosumers, creating new expectations, and really starting to force change in that wider world to create some kind of a transition. And we're not quite sure what shape that transition will take, but it will be very interesting. What the framework also invites us to think about is multi-level energy cultures. So thinking about energy cultures at an individual level, and then at a household level. So what's the interplay between how I, as an individual, carry out my daily energy-related activities or my mobility activities and the rest of my family? And so how do we negotiate that relationship between the individual and the household around energy? at a higher level, it could be that the businesses around me or the local authority is actually forcing or constraining me to do things or offering opportunities for my energy culture to either stay as it is or to change. And at a higher level still, the government is going to be having a set of expectations and infrastructure and policy environments that are creating constraints or opportunities for the energy cultures that are within that circle of influence. And at the highest level of all, of course, there are global influences that are occurring too around the global energy culture. And we're already seeing, for example, some changes occurring in the norms, even of major oil companies, about where they see the future of their business. And that will likely drive changes in their practices and investments, i.e. their material culture, in time to come. What I'm interested too, and I think there's a challenge here for the policy environment, is actually thinking about the government itself as having its own energy culture. And that material culture is the infrastructure and assets that the government is responsible for. So what are they investing in and what choices are they making there? What are the practices that the government is engaging in that are actually influencing other energy cultures? So the everyday decisions and actions of government agencies, their procurement policies and so forth. And finally, government norms. And I think these are reflected in law, regulation, and policy. So how are these expectations that the government has about the future built into or locked into or reflected in our law, regulation, and policy? And this is a space, in fact, that Barry and I were just talking about over lunch. So just to conclude, we have found the energy cultures framework for us, and I think for some other people around the world, as a really useful integrative model. It supports interdisciplinary research. We find it is wonderfully accessible to both academics and non-academics. So it's an easy model to talk to about in a community, at a local authority, with a business. They get it. They might not get some psychological theory, but they get this one. It also takes into account the broad context of behavioural influences. It is not a behavioural theory in the sense that some of the theories that John was talking about, but it is something that gives us some framing around the idea that behaviour is important. We tend to use it in a way that's complementary with relevant theory, so we don't say the energy cultures framework is the only theory we use. We almost always have another theory that we're using alongside it, whether it's a social or a sociological theory or a policy theory. But it is very complementary with those, and often we refer to it as a kind of a gateway into other theories because they help us understand parts of that puzzle in better ways. It also supports multiple research methods, so qualitative methods, quantitative methods, policy research methods are all consistent with it. And as you saw, we can apply it at multiple scales. It helps us understand heterogeneity, and it's generalizable not just to energy, but also to mobility, to carbon, and probably to some other fields. It's also policy relevant, and I think, for me, most importantly, it really highlights the role of culture, each of our cultures, the cultures of the families, the businesses, and the countries that we live in, the role of culture change in transition. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you very much, Janet. So we have around just under 10 minutes or so for a couple of questions. Hi.
Thanks, Janet. As somebody who was initially involved in getting the energy cultures bid funded, I can't say how proud I am to see what came out of it. And any government people who are here, I want to tell you that I hope you can see how good it is to invest in things like this, and please continue to do so. I know that, so from what I understand, this is not a model of understanding behavior, nor really a theory of change, but more like a framework for everything. But I'm quite sure, and I'm not sure if you addressed that already. I'm sorry if I'm asking something has already been asked, but the Chauvian elements model is something that can look quite similar. Can you say a little bit about the difference between those two?
The difference between practice theory and the energy cultures framework?
Yeah.
God, I get this so often. I guess there's two key differences that I'll just talk about, and one is with the energy cultures framework, we very much have the focus on the actor, on the actor as the core of this, rather than looking at practice as an idea that is a more, I guess, homogenous set of practices throughout a society, and trying to understand that. And that's an incredibly important thing to do, actually trying to understand practice as a concept and how that is rolled out. But we're much more focused on the actor and their own lives and how they get locked into a culture around those elements. The other thing I think that is a real point of difference is that the energy cultures frameworks are very much focused again on thinking, how do you actually drive change within a system? At an individual level or at multiple levels. So it's a real focus on the change process, not looking at so much at stability or homogeneity or stasis, but much more looking at how do we actually look for a lever or an opportunity to support change within this system.
Sorry, just as a quick view from a slightly outside point of view as well, is of between the Shrove view on life and the energy cultures view on life, one works and it's useful, one isn't. But anyway, that's a viewpoint from an engineer. one's accessible, one isn't accessible, and one talks about how you can observe something, whereas the other one looks at how you can change something. And I think that's a key difference, and that's what I find particularly useful, having explored both of them. Anyway, Janet, the question that I wanted to ask you was to say, where to next with energy cultures? What do you think the interesting challenges that we can start to look at? Is it going to be things like health systems, other systems that we might look at? What are the upcoming challenges that you think that where you see this starting to be used?
Right. Well, I'll talk about three things. One is just a little one, but it fascinated me. So our university has an academic leadership training program, and sometimes they pull me in to help run sessions. And I had this idea when we were talking about how to change really. They use the word culture, I think, of a department. And I thought, oh, I wonder if the energy cultures framework might be useful here. So I hauled it out, polished it up, gave it a few more kind of, basically used it, but used it in a different way and presented it. And we had people falling over themselves with excitement because finally they could put their finger on things in their department that could literally be changed in order to try and change the culture. So it's what is our physical environment? How does that reflect our values? Are our values explicit? Are our norms actually really clear? What are we on about? What are our daily practices? How do we bring people together in order to engage with each other on topics? And so it was really helpful, and also within that outside ring is saying, okay, we're in a university environment with particular rules and expectations about how we behave, so that constrains us to an extent. But within that, we've got a reasonable amount of freedom to actually determine our own culture as a department. And people found that really empowering. I suppose on the bigger picture, the areas that I'm really interested in and find really essential for it being addressed, of course, one is climate change. So two aspects to that. How do we use something like the Energy Cultures Framework to help us think our way into an approach to reduce emissions across many parts of New Zealand's sector, maybe even including agriculture. And the other side of that coin is how do we actually think about the adaptation process in a way that actually accounts for people's current cultures of lifestyle and aspirations, but actually improves their materiality. And the third area, in fact, we've got a funding application in for this at the moment, and I really hope we get it, but there is absolutely no certainty one way or the other. But the piece of work we specifically want to do is to retain the energy cultures team with a little bit of additional expertise in transport engineering, and to do some work specifically on how do we reduce the carbon emissions from New Zealand's vehicle fleet. And that, to me, is an incredibly important area for New Zealand, and somebody has to do it, and I would love it to be us.
Okay, well, thank you again, Janet, for that. Thank you very much. Okay, we'll move on now to the rest of the session, which is all about creating behaviour change. And first of all, I'd like to introduce C. Rotmann from the International Energy Agency Demand Side Management Task 24. And C is going to be talking about helping the behaviour changers or how to create systemic change. Welcome, C.
Is this loud enough? Not loud enough? I should be loud enough without a microphone. Sorry, I put it on the PDF just to be difficult. Broke it. No.
Okay.
Or maybe in tools, is there a slideshow in the tools? Nope. Okay.
How do we go on?
Yeah, just a full screen. Sorry, guys. Oh. Oh, dear. Going to be challenging. All right. Oop. So can I just press this?
Yep.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Welcome. I'm going to be talking about helping the behavior changers. Still not loud enough? It's so rare that I'm not loud enough. Not used to it. Okay. Whoops. Okay. Do I need to hold this? Can you hear me? Okay. So task 24 is a task from the International Energy Agency's Demand Side Management Program. It is the first task under this International Energy Agency research contract amongst all these OECD countries. That is actually looking specifically at behavior. So it's a global behavior change research task. It is multidisciplinary, looks really at all disciplines that have anything to do with behavior. It looks at all the sectors. It is a very broad definition of demand side management, not just in the utility and electricity sector. Instead, it's actually also including transport, small to medium enterprises, et cetera. We use storytelling. Very successfully. You'll hear some about that today, but you'll hear a lot about it tomorrow if you come to my workshop. And we also use social networking and various quite creative tools in order to disseminate the task. And Janet is one of our many experts in the task. We have over 250 experts from around the world, and she's our New Zealand expert, or one of them. So in a tweet, I like tweeting, so basically, the overarching impact of the task is to provide this helicopter overview of the best practice around behavioral theory and how you can use this theory to turn into practicable change. And that's by creating guidelines and tools for actual behavior changes, as we call them. So we had two phases of the task. The first one is completed. Just a quick overview. It ran until last year. We had 8 financially participating countries from around the world. We had another 9 countries that did a lot of in-kind work. As I said, we now have over 250 behavior change experts that are involved in it, and over 45 publications and 60 case studies came out of it. This is what we looked at. International Energy Agency research tasks are broken up into different subtasks. I'm going to talk a very little bit about this first one, which is called the helicopter overview of different models and understanding of change. What's really important to say is that our audience is not actually the end users of energy whose behavior everyone is trying to change. Instead, our audience is the behavior changers, and that's a term that Janet helped me come up with, because we had dinner one night and she actually said, I was talking about what I'm really trying to do with this task, and she said, you want to change the behavior of the behavior changers, and I was like, that's exactly what I want to do. So we ran with that, and what we broke our behavior changers out into, and you're all in the room, is government or the decision makers, industry or the providers, researchers or the experts, the third sector or the conscience, and intermediaries or the middle actors, the doers. And tomorrow you'll hear a lot more about that during the workshop. But the decision makers don't always have to be government, depending on who the end user is, whose behavior we're trying to change by using our framework. The decision maker could also be, for example, a CFO in a hospital or the dean of a university, etc. So this was our baptism of fire. Some of you were there. This was Oxford University in 2012, our very first and largest workshop to date, where we went to the international behavior change community and talked to them about our great idea of how we're going to change the world with this, and were widely shot down in flames. But that's a great thing about going out to social scientists from many different disciplines, is you learn a lot. And so what started out as a great hero story for Task 24 ended up being an even greater learning story. This was the overview of what happened on the day. We cartooned it all. It looks a lot more benign than what I felt like when it was happening. So one of the really big things that came out from this workshop in Oxford, where we really did have all these different social scientists start beating us and each other, was that definitions are incredibly important in the social sciences. I have to admit, I'm a marine biologist. I'm an actual marine ecologist who studied coral behavior, so I'm slightly upgrading myself to human behavior here on the evolutionary scale, but I also have to learn a lot. There's a big difference in how you use language as a biologist as you do as a social scientist. And so one of the things that Janet especially helped us with, again, is the realization that we need to be incredibly careful of how we define behavior, because behavior is a very loaded term in the social sciences. And so what we needed to do is we needed to define things like behavior or demand set management or behavior change very, very broadly in order to fit with the very broad research that we were doing here. And thanks to Janet, who helped us with this, we came up with a very broad definition of these things, which in the end everyone was happy with, or at least could live with. And then I went back to the IEA and said, behavior is everything. That did not go down as well as you might think. It's largely due to the fact that we were really lucky, because when we came up with this first global behavior change research task, it was very much being at the right place at the right time. I'd been to the IEA representing New Zealand for a few years on the expert group of research and development. I was always the one person who kept asking why they weren't talking about conservation and why they were only talking about technology and why they weren't talking about human beings. And I was annoying enough for long enough that finally it was kind of regarded that maybe we shouldn't be so technocratic and maybe we should look at the human aspect, as difficult as that aspect is. This was going a little bit too far, but what I meant with it was not to say that behavior is better than all the other things that the IEA was looking at, like technology and markets and business models, but that it kind of underpinned everything, behavior in this wide definition as we are using it, and that these other things are the means to the end, very important means to the end. But I didn't bring that across as well, and we'll hear about that later. So another thing that we realized we needed to do is we really needed to look at all these different models that Janet has also talked about that are out there and how they're being used. And fortunately, a chap called Andrew Danton in the UK government did a really great overview of all the different models of understanding and theories of how to change them. And so we used this as a basis to look at case studies from around the world and see how were these models used implicitly or explicitly and to what effect, and why were they successful and why they weren't successful, and that actually gave us a lot of really great learnings. So here's the Chauvian model. We had Elizabeth Chauve there torturing us relentlessly on the day, quite rightfully so. But then one thing that really came out when we looked at this was George Box's very, very pertinent quote that all models are wrong, but some of them are useful. And I would say probably all of them are useful, but you need to know what you're using them for. So another thing that came out, and Janet has also addressed it already a little bit, is that language is a real problem and can be a barrier. And we're not just talking about the different disciplinary languages that are looking at behavior, but when you're talking about working with behavior changes in all the sectors, there's many, many other different languages, like policy language is very different from sociological language, is very different from the language of the end user, is very different from the language of an engineer who's building a new technology. And so what we realized also during this workshop was that we basically need to become Babelfish. And if you haven't read Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, you absolutely must. And that's basically to be a translator between all these different sectors and all these different disciplines and finding the overarching language. And that really was our eureka moment during this workshop, where we discovered that storytelling is that overarching language. And that really sent us off on a journey where we started using storytelling and narratives as the overarching language of task 24. And we're still doing that. So one of our experts in the UK, at Sheffield Hallam, said, storytelling is the construction of a desirable future based on a narrative of past events with a plot that expresses some causal relationship. We wrote a paper about this, and there is now, and Benjamin unfortunately is gone, but he let us do a whole special edition in Energy Research and Social Sciences, which we have just closed our abstracts for, and we got over 30 abstracts on stories, storytelling and narrative in energy and climate change research from around the world. And Katie Janda and Mithra Motsi and I are going to have a lot of fun going through that. So storytelling in energy is going to become a valid tool. Stories are, of course, universal. They help us process information. They provide multiple perspectives. They are not one truth, so they are subjective, but that's okay because life kind of is. They aid recall, because we turn everything into a story anyway. They shape identity and they make connections. And it's actually a valid social science tool. So this is not just me having gone insane and dragged the International Energy Agency down with me, but it's actually a valid tool. And it's getting validated, for example, by all these great stories that we're collecting in this journal. We've collected stories from all of our experts, and there's some really great energy stories that you get out of asking energy efficiency experts about how they use energy at home. We've also asked our countries to give us the country energy story. This is my favorite. I told our South African expert to tell it as a Western, and so he told it as the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's online. It's well worth watching. It's only a Petra Kutcher, so it's only 6 minutes long. And Katie Janda wrote a really great article about how energy efficiency is looking at different types of stories, how we want it to be a hero story and how it should be a hero story, but how it usually ends up being a learning story and how often the learning stories are actually more important than the hero stories. How sometimes they can turn into a love story or a caring story, like what we've talked about with Warm Up New Zealand and the fact that health and comfort and kids as respiratory diseases and stopping them from getting sick is more important than kilowatt hour reductions. And then, of course, we all want to avoid the horror stories, even though they're usually the best ones to tell. And tomorrow at the workshop, you'll hear about the different kinds of stories, and we're going to tell some of them ourselves. I believe there are some ninja stories as well. Somehow Task 24 has become a little bit of a ninja story, the way it kind of slipped in there and started bashing down some of the conventions. But I think behavioral economics, for example, is kind of a ninja story because that managed to insert itself in world governments, often very right-leaning ones, and inserted psychological principles and even some sociological principles that usually were not really fitting into that neoliberal model of the utility-maximizing rational actor. So many different stories to tell in energy efficiency. So what's the moral of the story of Task 24? There is definitely no silver bullet anywhere, not in behavior, not in technology, not in one model of understanding. The Homo economicus really doesn't exist, only in chimpanzees, and I say that as a biologist. They have found that chimpanzees are the true utility-maximizing rational actors, not humans. Habits are the most difficult things to change, but most of our energy use is habitual. Moments of change are usually the best time when you can address habits. There is no such thing as individual energy use, and I really believe that the most individual energy use that you can do is when you're alone at home at night and you turn the light off and you make that choice, and that is still going to be informed by some social cue that you would have received as a kid or in school or in the office when there was a sticker on the light, etc., etc. We need to look at whole system societal change. It can't be done in isolation by one sector. Collaboration is absolutely the key. Everyone has a different piece of the puzzle and brings different tools to the table, and we need to put them together, which is why we need a shared learning and collaboration platform that works and a shared language. And ultimately, it's all about the people. And that led us to phase two, which we're in now, which is where we're actually starting to look at how can we bring all this theory and all this theoretical learning and this meta-analysis of case studies into practice that is useful to the actual behavior changes. And so what we did is we have another set of subtasks that we're looking at, and they all fit in together, and they're actually looking at the what, the who, the how, the why, the so what, and then the different subtasks from phase one nicely feed into that. So one thing that we realized very quickly is that the system is actually the problem, and the way that we look at the energy system is a very technocratic way that fits our current socioeconomic political model. However, the end user usually is kind of the guy down the end that everything is being done to. It's very much a kind of linear model that goes from the top down and from the left to right. We are saying that the energy system is actually a circular system and a very human system. I'm not going to talk you through that right now, but I will tomorrow at the workshop. So what I'm saying is come to my workshop tomorrow. but what we do say, and that is actually a big change, is we're recasting of how you view the energy system from the technocratic to the human lens. And so what we say is we pose that the energy system begins and ends with the human need for the services derived from energy, and that behavioral intervention using technology, market, business models, changes to supply and delivery of energy are the all-important means to that end. So to most of you in the room, this is not rocket science. To the IEA, this is actually a big way of changing how they look at things, because they usually start with a policy or a technology or a widget or a new market model or a new fuel. And they even tried to use behavior as like the seventh fuel or something, which just really doesn't work. We're using a collective impact approach, which is used by social entrepreneurs. Basically, it's a very common sense way of ensuring that different stakeholders with very different mandates and ideas can work together collaboratively. And we're going through a process during working with our stakeholders where we first decide on what are the top demand side management issues in each of the countries that are participating in us. We're zoning in on the top three. In New Zealand, it was transport, of course, particularly mode switching. It was insulation, particularly around or building retrofitting, especially how we can deal with the principal agent landlord issue. And then what we're actually working on as a case study, which is how we can do this fractal grid community sharing scheme, because PowerCo is one of our co-funders and they're doing a great pilot on that. And so we are going into it, and then we're looking at what's the technical potential, the economic potential, the social potential, the political potential, what are the risks on each of those levels, and what are the multiple benefits, because the IEA in particular, and thanks to something like the Warm Up New Zealand project that has shown that health is such an important co-benefit, has now really clued onto the fact that it's the multiple benefits of energy efficiency that are probably more important than the kilowatt hour savings or even the money savings. And we're now starting to look more and more at what are all these different benefits that we're accruing to all these different behavior changes in the system. Then it's really important to identify very clearly who is the end user that you want to change. Is it tenants? Is it office workers? Is it drivers? Is it building management operators? And we're looking at all of them in the various case studies that we're looking at in Task 24. Who else can it be? It can be anyone, but you need to identify him very clearly. And then it's what behavior are we actually trying to change? Again, you need to be very clear to focus in on what it is that you want to change. So in New Zealand, as I said, we're looking at sharing PV across neighborhood. In Sweden, we're looking at co-creating green leases in office buildings between landlords and tenants. In Canada, we're looking at building management operators in hospitals and how you can improve the documentation and communication to the energy users of the hospital. In Holland, we're looking at how to better use ICT in universities. And in Ireland, we're looking at training middle actors in communities of how they can actually improve community-led energy efficiency changes. So it's very interesting and very practical kind of examples. What we then use is what I call my magic carpet, which where it goes a little bit magical and fairy-like again. So we're looking at who are the right people that we need to invite into the room if we want to change that particular behavior of that particular end user that we're looking at. And then we have this, which actually ends up being a physical magic carpet that we're using to actually identify of how the system works. Here is the example from Canada. This is what it looks like in the end. Here we were in New Zealand. This is actually just showing like a twister exercise where you actually show how much people in the room are already working together and related to each other. Being New Zealand, everyone had like to use every single one of their limbs. In some other countries, in some bigger countries, you have some people actually standing completely outside of the circle, which is also very telling. This was at the ECEEE summer study in France where we had a workshop with over 50 people, and tomorrow we're actually going to do again, we're going to run through this exercise. We're going to use Wellington Zoo as an example. We're going to help Wellington Zoo design a new behavior change program for the staff. And then this all goes into an animated Prezi, and I know this looks super messy, but when you actually follow it through, it explains it quite easily. It's animated. And yes, we have bombs and love hearts in this as well, because you need to show the conflict. So basically, we're still on a story. It's going to continue for another 2 and a bit years, and I hope some of us will join us, especially tomorrow. That is also means some of you guys are going to need to fill out the story spine that I sent around, because I've only gotten 3 replies so far, and it's going to take us a lot longer tomorrow if you don't do that. So please look at my email and fill in the story spine. And if there's one thing, one moral of this story that I want you guys to take home, it's all about the people, and that's every one of you in here as well. So thank you.
Thank you very much, C. Okay, I'd like to introduce our next speaker, and that's Paul Thorsnes, and he is from the Department of Economics at the University of Otago and the Energy Cultures Project. And Paul's going to talk about helping householders choose variation in preferences for aspects of energy efficiency improvements. So welcome, Paul.
Save me. It's all about the people. Hmm? Oh, here, let me see if I can get this. Sorry about that, I didn't do the sound check. I'm really making a mess of this. How's that? Can you hear me all right? Yep. Okay, yep. So the segue, I guess there was a couple of segues, actually. I'm kind of keen to get up here because I'm expecting to feel a little bit of residual energy, and I do. She was giving it off. Solely potential. Fair enough. Okay, we'll see if we can do something with that. Going to go from really, you know, obviously some real broad brush, big think there with C, to something a little bit more specific. You can see that I'm the tame economist on the crew. I'll be looking at, it really is about the people. I'll be looking at, in particular, about something that I've experienced myself, and that's residential retrofits, another little segue on one of C's slides, and looking in particular at people's preferences. So I think it might be best if I just carry on. We've got a big, as again, last segue, we really do, we're looking at services. We have a pretty simple objective. We'd like to change those houses that Janet showed, and I'll show, from being kind of a wee bit cold to warm and healthy, and energy efficiency, and energy efficient, and in the context of diversity. That's what I'm really going to focus on. So, of course, we've got a lot of diversity in New Zealand, lots of differences in climates, and, of course, seasonally as well. And we've got a lot of, oh, I can use this thing. We have... Which one's the button for the laser pointer? Yeah. Oh, I got it wrong. That one. Thanks. We have a lot of diversity in households as well. This one, you know, I just kind of put this together looking for different, you know, examples, but I realized that was me when I got here, and this is us, my family, when we came to New Zealand, and now we've morphed into a combination of that one and that one. And we also have a great diversity of houses. And this one, I pinched these photos from the Brands Renovate site. And they're representatives of different epochs in houses and housing construction and design over the last century. And the reason they're there is because each one offers its different opportunities and constraints in terms of making renovations. And all of them have in common that they were built before insulation requirements were imposed. So, you know, these aren't that old villa that you showed. These are really pretty nice houses. There could be examples in my neighborhood. Some of them are architecturally very nice, pleasant to live in. and certainly not, certainly well worth renovating, but challenging to do that. When I first came to New Zealand, we rented a house that was not like, not exactly like these, unique in its own way, and architecturally very interesting. In fact, it was probably the most architecturally interesting refrigerator I've ever lived in. Staggering and very hard to fix. Really hard to fix. In fact, so hard to fix. We had the chance to buy it. I liked it. I liked its location. I just couldn't do it. And we went to a 1965 house, which still didn't have a stitch of insulation in it, but it did have some great sun and, again, great location. We liked the house, but I'm at this retrofit, trying to work my way down the retrofit journey in that house. And in doing so, I face all this, a great diversity in retrofits. And so a big issue, I think, is helping people, helping householders, including myself, I got my own motivation here, in figuring out how best to generate this simple outcome that I'd like, and I get on sunny days, with inputs that have that are kind of complex in their characteristics. They vary a lot, every one of these things, and in ways that you kind of need to be a technician to understand. And they really need to work well. You know, they need to work well. I'm talking about changing, you know, material culture, but the material culture has to change in ways that fit in with either the current energy practices or probably changes in energy practices, and also has to, you know, all these things have to work together in this context of a lot of different, so many different, such diversity in the housing stock and the population and climate. And so really when you're going to make retrofits, you've got, it's really quite a challenge, and it's going to make some complex trade-offs, and that's of course what interests me as the economist, is we have to make trade-offs. So one of the questions that came up a long time ago for this reason is just thinking, okay, how variable are we when it comes down to it in making, in this willingness to make trade-offs? And we did a couple of surveys over the course of the Energy Cultures projects that shed some light on that. And we, the process we went through is to first realize that, these identify all the ways in which, or at least most of the ways, many of the ways in which these retrofits vary in their characteristics. It's sort of like, we've seen examples along the way here. Barry brought up with the kind of the aspects of cars, of electric cars, that there's advantages and disadvantages. Other cars, different. So we went, did two separate surveys. I'm going to talk about them briefly in what I think is logical, but not the chronological order. We did it the other way around. In the way I'm going to talk about it. In each case, though, we went back and identified sort of clusters of people. And I do want to emphasize what I think this preferences does, what I mean here. I think it reflects. Preferences are that households have depend on a lot of things, where they live, their backgrounds, their household situation, and also just stuff that's really hard to pin down. My brother and I are very similar demographically, and we're very different in our preferences. I don't know why. But it's picking up all of the influence of all of these factors, I think. So what we did, first of all, started in Dunedin. This was our first study was one that was really run by a great master's student I had, very energetic. We recruited 149 owner-occupiers in Dunedin. We wanted to get a range of, wanted to look at a range of households and houses and households, and he succeeded. We've got quite a bit. We've got respondents from across the age group, gender balanced beautifully from our respondents, a lot of people with a lot of different qualifications, and of course, incomes and household compositions a lot, and a lot of houses built before the insulation requirements were put in. And so therefore we've got quite the range in how much has been retrofit in these houses. A lot of a lot of ceiling insulation and a lot less of all the other types. And so all of these houses were kind of somewhere at the beginning of a retrofit journey. So what we wanted to do, our first step was to just find out what out of many possible characteristics of energy efficiency improvements. Here we came up with 19. I think in the end we found there's more than that. These are what Oren used. Which of these they would pick? You know, what do they care most about? And so you might think, you know, John was talking about data quality, and you might think, oh, they're just taking a survey, they'll just tick, 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 tick. But this was part of the first version of what Janet was talking about, personalized energy priorities. What they were really doing here, the motivation would have been for them, is if they tick these boxes, and there's an intermediate step as well, but it leads down to what we were trying to do is organize or prioritize information about retrofits, the kinds of things they might like. It's kind of like if you're looking for a new car on Trade Me, you could say, well, I'm interested in a car in this price range, I'm interested in a car wherever it is, that's close by, I'm interested in a Toyota, that sort of thing. If they're clicking these things, we can resort kind of an encyclopedia of information that might at least be a little bit of help in their search for information. So they were motivated, at least. And I think a lot of them were, you know, kind of interested in it. They did it because they were interested in it anyway. So I think the data quality might be okay. They wouldn't just tick, 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 tick. So what do we find? Well, both consistency and variation. We've got, it's a shock that everybody liked value for money. they liked it to work reliably, and even two-thirds of them, more than half, thought energy efficiency was important. But we also found quite a bit of variation. One of the things quite a few picked up was independence from the grid. They ticked that out of their six out of 19 that they could pick. And there were two types of clusters. One group that picked independence from the grid also were concerned about environmental benefits of what they're doing. And the other, not too surprisingly, were independent-minded, like to have DIY install. But there were some other clusters as well. Fits with the house was an important one, and that's not surprising. We'll see that come back. Some were concerned that the house, we get value from our work. We get value back when we sell the house. And, of course, people who live in damp houses like ventilation, and, of course, with kids, you'd want safety. The consistency, there isn't that much variation. There's a lot of consistency, actually, as well. So the next question comes up, well, within that consistency, within, you know, people care about the same kinds of things, do they trade them off? How willing are they to trade off? So we used a different kind of survey to tackle this. And this one, I'm not so sure about that. Well, I'll have to get into it. So basically, the way a trade-off survey works is we say, we just present what, a chuckle? We want to do a trade-off question. Do you prefer one? And here we had these, we had to pick a subset of the attributes, as it were. We had disturbs your neighbors and depends on energy from the grid were the attributes. And we had one choice where, well, it disturbs your neighbors a bit, somewhat due to noise or smoke, and it's not dependent on the grid at all. And of course, in my mind, I immediately think of my neighbor who burns coal to heat his house. Great, really nice guy, heats his house very effectively, but does disturb at least one of his neighbors. Or one that's different, that requires a trade-off. So assuming everything else is the same, they work through a series of these trade-off questions. And you know, then you get some information about how their relative strength of preference for these various attributes. In this case, we went for a national sample, and we did do that. I think John mentioned, went to the market research firm. They're motivated by earning points. We needed people who were internet savvy, because the software we were using was an internet-based survey. Hope for the best. We did, again, we got quite a few, 22% response rate, quite a few responses. Demographic profile similar to New Zealand's was the target. And we got a lot of range. We did get the variation we really wanted. Whether or not, you know, how the quality, I don't know, but I think some of the results seem plausible. So what are they? Okay, numbers. I got to show you what we get. This is what this really is what the program we used spits out, is just numbers. And each one of those numbers represents kind of a strength of preference. So if we look at just this, just a few of them, we say, well, what do people like? The biggest number corresponds to low upfront cost. People care about cost. Barry's right. People care about that upfront cost. And in this case, the 8 corresponds to how much weight in relative terms they put on, whether it's the extent to which their improvement capitalizes into the value of the house. Will they get their money back when they sell their house? And it kind of makes sense on average when you think, right now I'm spending a bunch of money. It may be many years before I sell the house. Doesn't matter that much to me. And along the way, I'm going to get a lot of value from it. Maybe this is perfectly, yeah, sensible on it to think that this is. So as we look at this, what we've got is, so this is sample average results. If I averaged everybody, low upfront cost is number one. But they're all, if you really look at it, they're all, people care about it, all of them to some extent. What's interesting is when you look at the variation, for somebody, 4 out of 100, really, the total adds up to 100, they have very little weight on the upfront cost, even though even the mins are, that's the biggest. Somebody put 50% of the weight. Anytime they saw that thing, they say, I care about upfront cost. And even down here at Independent of the Grid, somebody put a third of the weight just on that. So there's a lot of variation. And so what we want to do is look at that, kind of come up with a way to look at that variation. And so what we did was cluster. What we tried to do is say, let's pick out, find those, you know, profiles like this that for individuals that are kind of similar. And we came up with 5 different clusters that are kind of interesting, I think. One was a cost-constrained cluster. It's not a, they put a third of the weight on that upfront cost. And a lot, about half that much on running costs. They care about cost. But it's not a huge group out of this sample, at least. There's a practical group. This one, if you look at it, they care a lot about the energy efficiency. They don't care that much about cost. They're willing to spend the money if it's energy efficient and it works like it's supposed to. It's easy to operate and it fits with the house. There's what I call an investor group. This one was kind of defined by their eagerness to recover their investment, the cost of their investment when they sell the house. But if you look at it kind of overall, they're concerned about the financial matters a lot. But they also have a little bit of, they have some other ones, fits with the house still sticks up in there. There's a considerate group. People who are put a lot of weight on not disturbing the neighbors or themselves. Again, concerned about cost a bit, fits with the house. And there's that independent group, which is actually the biggest group. The biggest group at 28%. And really, that's just relatively strong interest. But they're still concerned with fit with the house, still concerned with the money, but kind of distinguish themselves by that interest in being off-grid. So what does it imply for, what does all this imply for helping people choose? So what are the kind of the policy implications?
If we can do something financially, that's going to help. It's not just the cost-constrained group, but there were others that were concerned. If you go back and look, it really sort of, some of these are dimmed out, but there's a lot, generally fairly much weight put on cost. And one of the things that really struck me was that fit with the house, that kind of, or you have to everything work together. So the practical group, they definitely benefit from independent testing and certification. We do some of that, of course. Brands does that. Consumer does that. There's some really neat things on that. And this is one that struck me, just in my little case, was the investor group. Maybe I'm one of the investor groups. I don't know. You put a lot of money, especially into insulating walls, costs a lot. And you can't see it. A lot of people don't know if they've got insulation in the wall, if some previous person has installed insulation. So it would be nice, and it is in, there are consents to do some sort of, in some insulation you need a consent, which gives, that record would be there, but a lot of things you do, what I did in my house, for example, how would they know, really? How would the buyer know? And how would they be confident that I did it right? The considerate group, well, labeling, of course, they like that. And then this one's kind of interesting to me, the independent group. So the first thing I think of, well, you know, technical information. But it's also, I don't know, there can be a community more. I don't know if they're so independent or if there's a community that can be involved. There's something to work on here, and maybe Scott will something to say consistent with that. So to sum up, I do think this. There's a lot of variation out there, and I do think it's glorious. But it is costly. There's so much variability that we have to work with. If everything was the same, it'd be simpler. So retrofitting older houses is costly, but so is the process of making good choices. So I guess that's the thing that struck me over time. 1 minute, perfect. What struck me over time is that I think that the value of the time I've spent thinking about and trying to organize retrofits exceeds the amount I've spent in dollars. It's a bit of a task. You know, which retrofits work best in my task? And I've made mistakes. I haven't thought ahead enough, I realize, and made some blunders along the way that I've had to pay for. So we need to, you know, it's important that we take the that we help people take the financial plunge. But it's also pretty important, and we're going well down this track, but it's helping them choose well and get the job done right on time.
That's great. Thank you very much, Paul. Sure. Okay, at this point, I'd like to invite all of our speakers back up. And we could have some questions. We've got about 15 minutes or so of questions. You've got a seat there. We'll be all good.
Thank you for that nice mind-shifting session. It was great. I was actually wondering whether you could all share a story about how you saw... Well, actually, I was very interested in what happened the day you worked out stories were the thing to use at the workshop. But also I thought, could you apply a quick storyline to an experience of that shifting realisation you've had within your research or you've seen others have whilst doing your research?
So once upon a time, you'll hear lots about that tomorrow. It was really during the Oxford workshop. As I said, it was a two-day workshop for the first day and a half. We spent a lot of time beating each other up. It was a bloody, bloody experience for me, especially because I'm not used to it as a marine biologist. It was my first experience with social scientists, especially in the UK. And it was quite antagonistic. I think some people really enjoyed quite the violence of it, but me not so much. And it wasn't that bad. Nobody got beaten. However, it felt like it a little bit. Metaphorically speaking, it is a story. And so somewhere halfway during the next day, we invited people other than scientists as well. So we had policymakers in the room and we had some people from community groups and from the industry, and they started getting more and more and more like, what are we doing? And there were some other IEA people there too. They were like, oh my God. We've made a big mistake. And so we had this beautiful lady called Joanne Ward, who is working in the community sector in the UK, and she stood up and she basically just went, and Janet, you may completely tell a different story, she was there, but that's my story. And she basically stood up and she said, enough of this. Like, it's enough. Like, we have to stop just fighting about these definitions, and we're going to have to do it differently. And then she actually told a beautiful story, which I don't remember, but she told a story about how she used stories with her community group, and then she was talking about storytelling, and suddenly everyone just went, ah, and we had this world cafe set up, which would have led to more bloodshed because it was all about models of understanding, and instead we quickly scrapped it and we made it all about storytelling. And it was the most wonderful 2 hours that we spent at this time, and everyone had a really great time during this world cafe, and it ended the workshop on such a high note that we're still talking about it like 4 years later. And this entire storytelling methodology that Task 24 has kind of gone on the path with, and that a lot of other people from the workshop have done as well, like Katie Jander, who've written a whole bunch of papers about it, has really come out of this kind of aha moment. It really was a eureka moment. And so for me, you know, that really shows the power of stories. I don't know, do you want to add to that?
Yeah. I guess I'll take it. I won't tell the same story as yours. I'll tell a different story altogether. But I will tell one story, actually, that is part of that Task 24 workshop. We actually had to film our own stories about ourselves, so talk a bit about our own lives. And C's story was absolutely glorious, because here she is as a behaviour changer. Are you embarrassed about the story?
No, it's okay. I'm embarrassed.
As a behaviour changer working in the energy efficiency space, she at that point lived in a tiny little house with absolutely no insulation on the cold south coast of Wellington, and drove a large gas guzzling Mercedes Benz.
Both of which are still true. You'll hear about that.
But in terms of our daily lives as researchers, I mean, I think we're never embarrassed to tell our own stories and to bring them into our research practice. And in fact, Paul was just reflecting on his own life. And I think our own life stories can really help us understand things about choice and decision-making and behaviour in a much better way than if you just pretend you're some kind of a survey instrument and don't actually have that reflective phase as well. And so I've learned a lot just by thinking about our own energy efficiency journey and warmth journey and kids moving away from home and what that means, much more so than as if I'd been observing somebody else's family.
Oh, stories?
Yeah.
You don't pass on this one.
Okay.
Ooh. I think everybody's in need of coffee and a half sleep.
Hi, Paul, I'm really interested in the PEP software because mostly it was also run on the Rate My Flat website, and I really enjoyed having it on there. I'm obviously have a bias towards landlords and interested in their trade-offs and decision-making, and I wondered if you had any insights or thoughts on how PEP might be applied to the rental housing situation.
Yeah, I think it's the best. Whoops, I've got two. Okay. Yeah, you know, in the rental sector, I think it has its not good enough yet. Sorry, in the rental sector, I think it's probably the most useful relative. You know, in homeowners, it's something that helps for homeowners, especially piecemeal. But it is a worry that so much needs to be done for, you know, so many steps at a time, and they each need to be integrated. They need to be coordinated so you get the end result that you want, which I didn't do very well. But in rentals, it seems like a lot of people, especially for student rentals like you've been involved with, you're in it for a short time. And so collecting information's difficult to begin with. And a lot of the things you do, sounds really loud, a lot of the things you do can be done fairly quickly. You know, windows are just a huge problem in some of the student rentals especially, and in a lot of other rentals as well. And there are some things you can do. Getting them fixed up properly, really doing it right, lots of money, lots of time, but you can do some things. And so I think it could, you know,
I hope it could really work for rentals, and just helping people if it's fun a little bit would be good as well to make that happen. Does that answer your question? I hope.
So I was struck particularly by your point about habits being hard to change. So those of us that are interested in practices and thinking about how practices can be dynamic over time. So I'm going to ask you, yeah, so you said that they are it's possible to change them at moments of change. And I was wondering if you could elaborate on what those moments of change might be.
Yes. So this is based on a theory of change by Kurt Lewin, who's done really good work in that field. And it's basically, so we know that about, 90-95% of our energy use is habitual and routine, which is why most of these ABC models, as we call them, that look at the rational change of things really don't work so well. And so he did different things like freezing and unfreezing, and he worked in big workshop groups. But one of the things that he found is particularly effective, probably the only thing that's effective, is to change habits during a moment of change, such as when you're having a baby, when you're taking your elderly parents in, when somebody gets sick in your house, when you decide to make a big purchase decision, when you move home, et cetera, et cetera. These are the times when, if you have the right middle actor or intermediary who intercepts you during this moment of change and actually talks to you about your energy journey in this new story of your life, is a very effective time when you could actually rationally then make changes that can lead to a much bigger outcome. And so that's why both the identification of these moments of change and the middle actors that can help you identify people during those moments of change, and that could be public health nurses or even midwives or real estate agents or et cetera, or car salesmen, you know, if you get them to actually be trained to identify them and then talk to these people about their energy journey during those times, I think that would be a really powerful way of actually changing habits.
And a good example of that is there's a move towards assisting people to become more energy efficient and get warmer, drier houses in the far north. And what they do there is if the nurses see a child of a family more than, I think, twice in a certain period of time, that automatically triggers somebody going into that house where the sick child is to actually work with that household around techniques to get their house warmer, drier and more comfortable. And that's a perfect example.
Hi, thanks for the presentations. They were all really great. I have a question for Zee and Janet. I'm really sorry to see if you already mentioned this in your presentation. I might have been too busy tweeting your presentation. So have you seen any kind of overlaps emerging between the different stories that you have collected? So have there been sort of some themes that are coming through, or are people doing this, you know, telling similar type of stories? Have you had any of that?
So, and you should watch the video, which a lot of us are in, where we're talking about our own energy story. That one's a really interesting one because it was energy efficiency professionals, and I just asked them to talk about what is really important to them in their own energy lives, what they think they do really well and what they think they do not so well. And some of the really interesting stories that came out of that was that travel is one of the things that most people, particularly the air travel associated with the work, they feel very bad about, and that was usually one of the biggest impacts. That some people who are more technologically focused are doing absolutely insane things with their house, like quadruple glazing. An old 300-year-old villa in Holland was one of our experts, for example. But a thing that really grabbed me, and Jeanette Fitzsimons, our former Green Party co-leader in New Zealand, she actually picked up on it and she said, I can't believe how many people are talking about sin. It became a really almost quasi-religious kind of thing where when you say, what do you do not so well? And people immediately say, oh, my biggest sin is, and oh, I feel so guilty. And it was almost this Catholic kind of like, oh, I take too many showers. It was, I mean, that was something that when you asked, you know, energy efficiency experts who know very much about it, that was really, really interesting. And just like how bad they feel, but how much it doesn't stop. I still drive my 1977 Mercedes. It hasn't stopped me. I try to drive it very little, but I drive it. I've got a good reason for it. It's not energy efficiency.
Yes, for Paul, a couple of related questions. Okay, a couple of related questions. You went through, the preference ordering using I'm an economist too, so I use that same paradigm. You didn't talk very much about the constraints and the options they have. The first question is, have you done that and see how significantly the actual actions people should take will depend upon these different preferences, first? Second, have you looked systematically about, you have in your sample those who own homes but rent them out to others, landlords, and see if their preference orderings are systematically different than owner-occupiers of homes? And third, have you seen whether that systematic difference leads to systematic differences in the choices they make or would optimally make? And have you gone that far in the overall paradigm that you set up?
No, but I do appreciate the suggestion. So this is, we've used, let me go to the first one. This is stated preference stuff. I haven't related it to actual choices, so granted.
But have you modeled the choices and see how at least the stated preferences, the different sets of stated preferences, would lead to different, at least hypothetical choices by your modeling of the various options that people, in fact, might have for upgrading their home? I mean, it's just a suggestion of a good suggestion.
I've only done it informally, just kind of cruising down and thinking about how that would go. And in the context of personalized energy priorities, we can feed these. So basically what happens in personal energy priorities, people choose the things they care most about, run through a choice survey that makes some of these numbers and use them as weights all of the retrofits are rated according to each one of the characteristics. And so then you can weight them. And then, so we have looked kind of informally about, you know, the different ordering these things produce. Let's see what they would see. Yeah, and do that. What was the other question?
Do you see systematic difference between landlords' preference orderings and owner-occupant preference ordering? We see in the empirical evidence, at least from California, big differences in the degree of energy efficiency updates, and where owner-occupants do a lot more energy efficiency upgrades than landlords do about.
Yeah, I think that's certainly, I haven't checked it, and it's a good one. That's certainly anecdotally consistent locally, and also it might vary between remote ownership and local ownership by landlords. So that's a really good suggestion. Thanks.
Okay, could we just give a final hand to our speakers? Thank you very much.